Harpers, it's Tiffany from TiffanyHarpandSong.com, and welcome to Let's Talk Harp, where we talk about just all kinds of harp-related topics. And today I'm going to show you some of my favorite ornaments that I use to decorate some of my tunes that I arrange. Since these can be very helpful in spicing up a Celtic tune and making them your own, I'm going to put this video in my arranging tips and ideas playlist, which you can find up there in the cards, if you want to see some more videos about arranging tunes for yourself. I have 8 different types of ornamentation, or maybe they wouldn't all be considered ornaments, but different things that I use in my tunes. This is definitely not an exhaustive list. This is just a list of what I have used and what I use the most. So let's get right to it. First thing I'm going to show you is the snap, sometimes called the Scotch snap or the Scots snap. And obviously you'll find it a lot in Scottish tunes. And it's this. This is where you have 2 separate notes and you'll just do one. The first one is very quick. And it's sort of sassy sounding. And this goes along in a lot of Scottish tunes, like I said, like Athol Highlanders. And I'll link a tutorial for Athol Highlanders if you want to learn that one. It's old, so I don't have a sheet music arrangement for it. That was before I was doing sheet music arrangements every month. But there is the session.org link in that video. So I will link that down below and in the cards. Here are a couple other tunes that have snaps in them, and if I have tutorials for them, I'll link them below. This one is The Cat That Kittled in Jamie's Wig. This one's O'er the Boughs to Ballandalloch, another Strathspey. So a lot of snaps in that one. The easy thing to do with snaps is it's easy to make them too close together and they get muddled, almost as if they're the same one. So you want them to be slightly separate, but not too far like this. There's too much space in between those. You want a good middle ground. And I think of the bottom note as being a little stronger. So you just want to practice those and get those nice and clear. You might also do this on 2 strings next to each other, so an interval of a second. This one is Drum and Castle. I'll also link that tutorial down below. Again, I don't have a sheet music arrangement of it because it's an older one, but I do have the session.org right hand music linked in within that video. So I don't even know if that would be considered a snap, just sounds like a little extra something. If you were playing this on a fiddle, it would be that little slide into the note. So you want them just a bit separate. Separate so they're distinct, but not so far apart that they sound like a totally different thing altogether. Like that would be a bit too slow. Just a little something extra. Another sort of ornament or extra thing you might hear in different tunes is this one, which I'm not really sure what it's called. But this is also a very distinctly Scottish sounding sort of ornament and happens a lot, I think, in Strathspeys. And what you're doing is just 2 fingers on the same note. I think it's easier for this kind of effect to use 2 and 1. And for this one, I think of the second finger, which in this case is the first finger, but the second time you play that note as the stronger one. And the first one is sort of just a quick extra thing. And that can go in tunes like this one. So there's quite a few here in the B section. This is called South Uist Golf Club. And there's another snap. 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 Lots of snaps in that one as well. Similar to that is what I think of as a two-finger roll. And this I used most recently on my arrangement of Carmen Vernale, which I do have sheet music for that one, and that tutorial is also linked below. But I put it on the end of that arrangement. Right there. And that's where we would take the same string, but using fingers 3 and 2. And then I end up on another note with my thumb. And it sounds really cool and kind of an old world sound. Rather than just one note. So that's something extra you can throw in. And now this one takes quite a bit of practice, okay, if you're not used to it. So doing it in slow motion, it's really just... And I think of your fingers as almost going down, curling towards your palm, starting from up here. And you can practice that by going down scale. Similar to that would be a three-finger roll, or sometimes they're called triplets, sometimes they're called trebles, and you'll see this a lot in Irish music, and I mean, I think I use it in Scottish music too. This one, there's a couple ways to do it. Well, there's probably 3 or 4 ways to do it, but the most common ways I see are 4-3-2 or 3-2-1, and it's the same idea as that two-finger roll. So if you can get that, you're halfway there. But this time, you would just add the fourth finger in there. So slowly. And by the magic of editing, I'm going to do it right on the first try. You can also do the same effect with 3-2-1. So this is one you might use in something like the Morrison jig, also a tutorial linked below. Definitely goes well. Here's another one that's really pretty to use in pipe tunes because it kind of sounds like a pipe ornament. Technically, I think the name of this one would be a bisbigliando, but I'm not sure if there's another folky name for it. And it's not too hard to do once you get some practice. It's really just 2 notes. You're using fingers 2 and 1 on each hand. You're playing 2-1 and then 2-1 of the same strings. And you could do that on 2 strings next to each other. You could do it on 2 strings with a couple strings in between, which sounds very pipey, I think. Pretty much as far as you can reach, you could try that. And here is an example of a tune that uses it. This is Wendy Stewart's arrangement, not mine. And I'll link the book down below in case you want to learn it, the one I got it from. This is Pipe Major Donald McLean of Lewis. The next one I'm going to show you could be called a turn. It's just where you sort of dance around the string you want with the notes around it. And here's an example of it in Fanny Power, again, tutorial below. So right there, instead of just going straight from, I brought in a D. It takes a while to get smooth, but you'll get there. I'm using 2, 1, 2, 3. Two more I'm going to show you today. This one is very prevalent. I use it a whole ton, and I've talked about it in my videos before, but in case you missed it, this is called the cut, and it's very easy to stick in just about anywhere. And you can do them right next to each other. A few strings apart. It's just where you are taking an extra note that you just left before you go to the note after it. So if I wanted to do, like in Leaving Lismore, tutorial below, and I wanted to make it sound a bit fancier, I could put an extra D before I go to that B. So this is different from the snap we learned earlier because the notes are just a wee bit closer together. That's how I think of it. Rather than a very distinct. So it's somewhere a little bit closer together. And usually I think of it as gentler, I would think. The final one I'm going to show you today is actually a wire harp technique that I learned from Ann Heyman, and it makes things have this nice old world sort of sound. It's where you play two strings close together, but you damp the string that you have just played so that they don't muddy up together. And of course this is really handy on wire harp because you have to unplay a lot of the notes because they ring for so long. But I think it sounds really cool on nylon or fluorocarbon harp as well. And there are two directions you can do this in. It looks like this. So you're using your thumb. I'm playing the notes A and G sharp, and you're using your thumb to stop the A right after you play it and before you go to the G. But you're also playing these notes pretty quick together. So it's basically a cut, but you're stopping the first note. So this one I use for my arrangement of Beloved Gregor. The other way you can go is going from the bottom note up, and that requires a little bit of a difference. So it takes a little bit to practice so you don't stop the note that you need to stay ringing, but only that one. And I do that by sort of bringing my hand out if I need to, a little bit. Think of it this way, as opposed to in towards the strings. And I use that a lot for, I've been playing Lament for the Death of King George V a lot. And that's all eight of the ones we'll go through today. Hey, thanks for watching this video. If you liked it, please give it a thumbs up and let me know what you thought in the comments. If you want to see more videos like this, make sure you subscribe over there and turn on notifications so you can check out the next one. At the end of this month, I'll be teaching a new tune like I do every month, so make sure you stick around for that. Don't forget to check the description for all kinds of helpful links down there, and I'll see you next time.